Guys, cross your fingers. There are still several months to the launch scheduled for next October 31st. But apparently in front of the James Webb Space Telescope, the instrument that is about to revolutionize astronomy has opened a fast highway without obstacles or clouds on the horizon. Developed by NASA with the collaboration of the European Space Agency and the Canadian Space Agency, the Webb Telescope should have been in orbit for a few years, at least according to the initial plans of its designers. But a host of problems has raged against this project. After all, building a satellite and putting it in orbit is difficult and expensive. But building a space telescope weighing 6.5 tons is enormously more so. Progressive postponements due to technical problems and various contingencies were compounded by economic ones. The planned cost in 1996 was about $2 billion, with a launch scheduled between 2007 and 2011. A first postponement brought the cost to $4.5 billion. After that, in 2011, followed a deep revision of the project, made of cancellations, reconsiderations, and battles with the U.S. Congress for funding. It is certainly true that the new space telescope will allow us to observe distant galaxies and stars with a definition never seen before, giving us the opportunity to observe the first lights that lit up the universe about 13.8 billion years ago. But in the end, it will cost at least $9.5 billion, and more than a billion will be needed for its maintenance and management of the mission once the telescope will be in orbit. Was it worth it? You be the judge. The proposal to build a new large space telescope, dedicating it to the memory of James Webb, NASA's director at the time of Apollo, was first floated in 1996. The idea, which still remains the basis of the project, was to offer an instrument for the observation of deep space to complement Hubble, the space telescope that for 30 years has been offering amazing and useful images for research on our solar system, the Milky Way, and other galaxies. While the James Webb Space Telescope is billed as the successor to the legendary Hubble Space Telescope, in a sense, it is not. The Hubble is primarily an optical telescope, capturing wavelengths of light similar to those used by the human eye. But the Webb is different. It will observe entirely in the infrared. In other words, it will study a universe drawn by radiation that reaches us from space at a much higher wavelength, and that is largely invisible to human experience. In trying to extend observations of the sky to these spectral bands, we are in fact faced with the problem of absorption by the Earth's atmosphere. In fact, only a small part of the infrared bands, the one closest to the red, is accessible to observation from Earth, while the mid and far infrared never reach the Earth's surface. The atmosphere becomes transparent again only at wavelengths longer than about 1 millimeter, making observations from Earth in the radio band possible. This is the main reason why infrared observations are only feasible from instruments placed at high altitudes or outside the atmosphere. The usefulness of making observations in this region of the electromagnetic spectrum is instead given by the fact that many sources of cosmic nature, such as galactic clouds, young stars, forming planets, emit radiation in this wavelength. Infrared observations also allow the study of objects and regions of space otherwise obscured by gas and dust in the visible spectrum, such as clouds where stars form, protoplanetary disks, and the nuclei of active galaxies. In addition, since the universe is constantly expanding, light from receding deep space bodies also tends to shift towards the red, thus reaching us with reduced frequency, red shift. These objects are therefore more easily detectable if observed with instruments optimized for the study of infrared frequencies. The Webb Telescope is one of the most powerful instruments ever built, capable of observing deep space as never before. To do this, on the telescope have been installed optical instrumentation with a high engineering profile, with innovative solutions tested during the design of this technological jewel. Among the features of the James Webb is certainly the primary mirror, which made the image of this new telescope immediately iconic. Webb's mirror is a gold-coated beryllium reflector, 6.5 meters in diameter, with a collecting area of more than 25 square meters. It's a huge thing, impossible to take into space in one piece. So the designers have divided it into 18 hexagons, which are to unfold after launch as kind of an origami. Each hexagon is covered with a very thin gold foil, which makes the surface reflective. Similar in size to large terrestrial instruments, James Webb will be the largest telescope ever brought into space. So sensitive that it will have to be protected from infrared radiation coming from heat sources such as Earth, the Moon, and the Sun, capable of confusing its observations. To solve this problem, designers of infrared space telescopes typically have a couple of options. The most common choice is to use a liquid coolant. This is an excellent solution, but one that severely limits the operational life of the telescope. In fact, when the liquid runs out, it is no longer possible to proceed with observations. The second is that of the parasol, which is the one adopted for the Webb telescope. Once in space, in fact, the telescope will deploy a solar screen as large as a tennis court. A structure with a bizarre shape, a kind of a cake with five layers, each of which has the thickness of a hair and made of Captain E, a type of polymer called polyimide with high resistance to heat. Each of these layers is coated with aluminum, and the two facing the sun also have a treated silicone coating to reflect even more heat. Each layer is also vacuum insulated and spaced out from the others. There is one problem, however. This sort of umbrella will obviously have to always stand between the heat sources and the mirror, which it could not do if after the launch the telescope was placed in orbit around the Earth. In that case, in fact, the orientation towards the Sun would change continuously, and moreover, the Earth and the Moon would even be looming and therefore not screenable. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you will help us to make products of even higher quality. Unlike Hubble, which orbits the Earth at an altitude of 600 kilometers, it has been decided that Webb will occupy the only point around Earth from which the Sun, the Earth, and the Moon can be shielded by a sunshade left in a fixed position, the Lagrangian 2 point of the Earth's orbit. This region is located 1.5 million kilometers outside the Earth's orbit on the Earth-Sun conjunction, and is one of the five theorized in 1772 by the Italian Giuseppe Lagrange as gravitational islands, where an object of small mass can maintain its position relatively undisturbed compared to bodies of greater mass. Because of this characteristic, the Lagrangian point L2 is an excellent space observation point due to the stability of solar illumination that facilitates thermal management of instrumentation and pointing to deep space. In addition, a great advantage related to this fixed position is that the telescope will occupy substantially always the same spaces in the night sky regions, and it will be possible to have continuous communications through three large antennas in Spain, California, and Australia that are part of the Deep Space Network, an international network of radio telescopes of the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. The arrangement of these three antennas covers every area of the Earth, giving the opportunity to communicate with the telescope without worrying about the Earth's rotation. At any time, there will be at least one of the three antennas ready to receive or send data. Many other instruments, such as the Planck Surveyor, the Wilkinson's Microwave Anisotropy Probe, the Herschel Space Observatory, and the Gaia Probe, have been placed in that region in the past, and the James Webb Space Telescope will be just the latest in the series. There is, of course, a price to pay. The main negative aspect of this positioning is related to the impossibility to intervene in the case of malfunctions. Webb will be so far from Earth that any component failure, not solvable at a distance, will decree the end of the telescope and the entire mission. It is therefore essential that Webb works perfectly. It will have to be a good the first, with no choice. Next July, the observatory will undergo a final overhaul and pre-launch exercise at Northrop Grumman Park in California. And then in August, it will be transported to the launch site in French Guiana. Once there, final tests will be performed. Then the spacecraft will be packed into the Ariane 5 rocket that will launch it into space on October 31st, 2021. Space launches are always an unknown, because it's enough for something to go wrong to compromise the mission. But in the case of Webb, that will probably not be the biggest difficulty. After passing Earth orbit, the telescope will continue to travel a long way to reach Lagrange 2. After a little less than 10 days of travel, it will begin to expose the hexagons that form the primary mirror. In the following week, the remaining mirrors will be added, and the huge sunscreen will be inflated. Everything will happen automatically at hundreds of thousands of miles from us, without the possibility of intervening or organizing missions to repair the instrument if something did not go the right way. Once operational, the Webb Space Telescope will allow to study every phase of the history of the cosmos, from the first bright flashes after the Big Bang to the formation of star systems capable of supporting life on planets like Earth. And it will make observations once thought impossible, discovering and studying distant planetary systems, analyzing the molecular composition of the atmospheres of extrasolar planets, and directly imaging Jupiter-sized planets orbiting nearby stars. And aside from the enormous surface area of the mirror, it's the instruments on the focal plane that will make all the difference. There are four instruments installed on board, including cameras and spectrometers. And all of them have detectors capable of recording extremely weak signals. One instrument in particular, the near-infrared spectrograph, has programmable micro-switches, allowing up to 100 objects to be observed simultaneously. Many of the objects that Webb will study, such as the first galaxies that formed after the Big Bang, are so faint that even its giant mirror will have to observe them for hundreds of hours to gather enough light to form a spectrum. And here's why during its five-year mission, James Webb will necessarily observe several distant objects at the same time. A goal never achieved before, and this will be the first spectrograph to possess this extraordinary ability to observe multi-objects. A very useful option, also considering that according to the forecast of the space agencies participating in the project, Webb will not have the possibility to live as long as Hubble. The duration of the main mission will be in fact 5 years, with the goal to extend it with a secondary mission up to 10 years in total. With the Webb telescope, astrophysicists and cosmologists hope to better understand how matter in the universe, both ordinary and dark, is currently organized on large scales, and how that organization has possibly changed over time from that distant epoch to today. Moreover, many of the astronomical objects of interest are hidden from our eyes by blankets of interstellar dust, opaque to visible light, but transparent to infrared radiation. In practice, observing in the infrared allows us to penetrate these clouds and observe what lies within, or even what lies beneath them. It is in these nebulae, huge volumes of gas and dust typically distributed along the spiral arms of galaxies like ours or similar to ours, that stars are born and planetary systems are formed. Other two important objectives of Webb are therefore the study of the birth of stars and protoplanetary systems, which subsequently lead to the development of planetary systems like ours, and an immediate consequence, the study of the formation of planets, their physical and chemical characteristics, in particular of the atmospheres of exoplanets, and the conditions from which life can originate. But that is not all. Still regarding the planets, Webb will not limit itself to point its giant eye to remote places and times, but it will help us to better understand the celestial bodies closer to us, or the planets of the solar system, asteroids, comets, objects of the Kuiper Belt, thus contributing with observations complementary to those produced by the various interplanetary missions to further enrich the knowledge of our planetary system. But then when you build an observatory with unprecedented capabilities, probably the most interesting results will not be those that can be expected or predicted, but those that no one can yet imagine.